doing today? Welcome to part two of a six-part series on this channel where we're going to go over all 18 blog posts that Chad Daybell made on his website in the fall of 2015. This is actually part two. If you haven't seen part one, it is listed in the description box down below. Be forewarned, I'm wearing the same shirt and have the same quarantine hair. Don't care. I'm recording multiple videos in one day, so please don't think that I've not changed my clothes in a week. Now, before we get started, welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, it is great to meet you. I definitely invite you to subscribe to this channel and follow the Lori Vallo and Chad Daybell saga along with us. I'm very proud of the community that's being built here, and I would love for you to be part of it. So with all that being said, let's go ahead and jump into parts 4, 5, and 6 of Chad Daybell's blog. Post number 4 is called How I Met Suzanne Freeman. In the late 1990s, as I was writing my novel, Escape to Zion, I began having many dreams and visions relating to my family's future. For example, one night I had a vivid dream that Tammy had taken the kids to the Spanish Fork Kmart. In the dream, I watched Tammy lead the kids across the parking lot into the store entrance. Then little Seth broke free and stumbled ahead of the others. I distinctly noted he was wearing a particular pair of blue overalls. Just then, a blue Cadillac driven by a Polynesian man came speeding by and ran over Seth, killing him instantly. The dream obviously disturbed me, but I had to leave for work before Tammy woke up. So later that morning, I called her. Before I could even tell her about the dream, she said, "I've got the kids ready and I'm taking them to Kmart." I immediately asked what Seth was wearing, and it was the blue overalls. I told her about the dream and we agreed I should go to the store with them. They picked me up at the cemetery and I carried Seth into the store. Everything was exactly as I had seen it in the dream in terms of the angle of the sun and so on. We didn't see a blue Cadillac though. I believe we altered the timeline by a few minutes when Tammy picked me up to go with them. I have no doubt it was a warning dream sent straight from heaven. Another dream I kept having at this time was that the Twin Towers were burning. In the dreams, I was always on the street below the towers. They were both on fire and people were running and screaming. I didn't know the cause. From my vantage point, it seemed like all of Manhattan was on fire. This dream had deep personal significance since I served my entire mission in New Jersey along the Hudson River. The Twin Towers were like a central beacon to me. I have several photos with them in the background, and we visited them when my parents picked me up after my mission. I even included what I had seen in Escape to Zion. In the book, the main character Emma is in the future, and she reads an old newspaper about the Twin Towers being burned. So it kind of threw me for a loop when it actually happened a year later. I continue to have sporadic glimpses into the future during this time, and I'll share more of those visions in later posts. But I want to give some background on my connection to Suzanne Freeman, the author of Through the Window of Life. Soon after I established Spring Creek Book Company in 2004, I was contacted by my friend Shirley, who is also an author. Suzanne had approached her at a book signing and told her about having a near-death experience. She was feeling prompted to share her experience, even though she was a shy person and was reluctant to do so. Shirley met with her, took some notes, and came away impressed by Suzanne's account. She then called me to see if I'd be interested in publishing Suzanne's story. Less than a week later, I met Suzanne at Shirley's home. She gave me a brief synopsis of her near-death experience. Then I asked her if she'd read other near-death accounts, wondering if she had borrowed some ideas from these stories. She shook her head, explaining she was a housewife with several children that occupied all of her time. She was familiar with the basic truths of her LDS faith, but said she wasn't a gospel scholar. She even mentioned she'd had dyslexia as a child and that reading still didn't come easily to her. I felt confident Suzanne was telling the truth, that a humble housewife from a small Utah town had actually died, met the Savior, and returned. However, before I'd even consider publishing her story, I wanted to make sure her account stayed consistent within itself. I began asking her many questions to see if she would slip up or change her story. But throughout the interrogation, she looked me in the eyes and was straightforward with her answers. After about 30 minutes, I felt satisfied and said, "I believe you. I feel we should publish your experience." Suzanne seemed uncertain whether she had heard me correctly. "Really?" she asked. You believe me? She then explained she'd been ridiculed within her family and in her community for even mentioning her experience, and she'd expected the same outcome from our meeting. I assured her that I believed her. Shirley joined us in the front room, and she agreed to help write the book. Within a few months, Led by the Hand of Christ was published, which told of Suzanne's various experiences while she was in the spirit world. While she was in the spirit world, Suzanne had also been shown a series of troubling future world events. At first, I pushed Suzanne to include these events in her book, but even talking about them caused her great distress, so I backed off. I sensed she had been shown those events for a reason, but possibly the time hadn't come for her to share them. Led by the Hand of Christ sold well throughout 2005, and Suzanne spoke to several groups about her experiences. As the months passed, she felt more comfortable with describing the future events she'd been shown by the Savior. She collaborated again with Shirley in sharing what she had seen, and Through the Window of Life was released in 2006. And it had told of troubling times America would soon face. It also became a bestseller, and in 2013, we released her third book, The Spirit of Liberty. I highly recommend all three of them, although Through the Window of Life is the one that focuses specifically on the events she saw. I greatly appreciate Suzanne and her willingness to share her experience. She helped pave the way for my novels and other books we have published. In my next post, I will share how I became the publisher for Julie Rowe, the author of A Greater Tomorrow and The Time Is Now. Throughout everything we've learned so far about Chad, I have always wondered, how is he able to pull people in and get them on board with whatever wackadoo belief system he has? This blog post lays it out. In my opinion, it appears as though he's exploiting anyone who claims to have had a near-death experience. He ropes them in and says, I believe you, this is the place for you, this is how we're going to do things. So people, in this instance, Suzanne Freeman, gets drawn into him, and it absolutely latches onto him because they're finally being accepted for what they've experienced. In a sense, I feel like Chad is just simply exploiting people for their story for his own personal gain. That means publishing their books and getting a little kickback from that. How it has evolved over time, we're going to find out a little bit in future posts, but we have to understand that these posts concluded in 2015. So the last 5 years, we really don't have a record of exactly his thought process. Post number 5 is titled Great Success, Then Disaster. After forming the publishing company in 2004, we soon found great success. We were producing 24 titles each year and had to move to a larger warehouse to stock our inventory and keep up with the orders. We published a variety of books by more than 50 authors, ranging from novels to sports books to helpful LDS titles such as Bright Ideas for Young Women Leaders, which is still our best-selling title. The LDS bookstores acknowledged our efforts by naming our company the Small Wholesaler of the Year at the LDS Bookseller Convention in both 2005 and 2006. We considered it a great honor since there were dozens of small wholesalers in the LDS market at the time. Dark clouds were on the horizon, though. There was talk of the economy slowing down, but the stores and publishers would reassure themselves that everything was going to be okay. A popular statement I often heard was, during the Great Depression, book sales actually increased because people still wanted to be entertained. Well, history didn't repeat itself in this case. Customers had many other ways to entertain themselves in 2008 than they did in the late 1930s. Our sales hit a brick wall. By that fall, it became evident that the nation really had entered a recession. Customers quit buying books, and the bookstore owners panicked. They started sending books back to us and demanding credit for them. It was a nightmare. Tammy and I saw the writing on the wall. We needed to find another way to support our family. We essentially put Spring Creek into hibernation. I turned over our remaining inventory to Brigham Distributing, and they shipped out our books whenever someone ordered them, which wasn't too often. I went back to my old standby job, the cemetery business. I was hired in January 2009 to become Spanish Fork City's new cemetery sexton. Tammy took a job at the Art City Elementary School as a computer teacher. Suddenly, I was working about 50 hours a week at the cemetery, clearing snow and digging graves. In retrospect, both Tammy and I were in shock at how quickly things had fallen apart. I was ready to put the whole publishing industry in the rearview mirror. We had felt so guided and inspired to start the company, and then 4 years later, we were done. I had written 3 volumes of my Standing in Holy Places series by this time, and I was about to call it quits on that project too. However, our cemetery secretary, Marty Warren, read my books and became a great support to me. Whenever I would take the cemetery paperwork to her at city offices, she would say, "When is that next book coming out?" or "I need more books." I gave them to my friends to read. She really was a great motivator, so I would go home at night and make some progress on the books, eventually finishing the series. One other item really bothered me. Soon after we published Suzanne Freeman's book, Through the Window of Life, in 2006, I had a vision of a tall, dark-haired woman who would publish her near-death experience with our company. It was a full awakening vision of her speaking to a large group in a spacious building with balcony seating, and I was sitting near her as she spoke. It was a distinctive voice that I would recognize anywhere. A few years had passed, and I was essentially out of the publishing business. I expected to be Spanish Fork Cemetery sexton until I retired, but something strange happened. We still had about 20 books in print, and as the economy improved, the sales of these backlist titles increased. Books we had published several years before were suddenly selling better than they had when we first released them. My novels also found a new audience, and I decided to write the Times of Turmoil series. The sales revenue still wasn't enough to leave my full-time job, but it gave me some hope that maybe the company could bounce back. I still had that tall, dark-haired woman in the back of my mind I had seen several years earlier. In January of 2014, I was checking a preparedness website when I saw a post by a woman named Julie Rowe who had said she had felt she should share her near-death experience. She asked if anyone knew someone who might be able to help her publish her experience, and I thought, I do. I sent her a basic email explaining that I was president of Spring Creek Books and I would be interested in hearing her story. We exchanged a couple of emails and then I called her to make the conversation easier. I still didn't know what she looked like, but I recognized the distinctive voice. She had a Facebook page at the time and I looked up her photo after we talked. It was the tall, dark-haired woman that I had seen. Julie began working on her manuscript and it came together quite rapidly, even though she lived in Arizona and I was in Utah. Her book, A Greater Tomorrow, was released in mid-May. I'd never even seen Julie in person until mid-July when our families met at BYU's Bean Museum. Later that same week, Julie spoke in the Logan Tabernacle to 700 people. As I sat near her on the stand while she addressed the crowd, the vision was fulfilled that I had seen many years earlier. In my next post, I will share more about publishing Julie's books and how they are helping people prepare for the future. Now, we have heard Julie Rowe talk about having the same experience about Chad. We have also heard Julie Rowe talking about her first book coming together within 3 weeks, and I do not think that Chad is wrong when he says you could recognize Julie's voice anywhere. I've made it very clear on my channel, I am not a Julie Rowe fan. I feel like at this point, anything she does is only to promote herself. I'm really not too keen on talking about her too much on this channel, but this next blog post is all about her. Blog post number 6 is titled, Publishing Julie Rowe's Books. Julie Rowe's book, A Greater Tomorrow and The Time Is Now, have been at the top of several bestseller lists and for many months, and I want to share some additional insights concerning how they were written and published. During one of our first phone conversations in January of 2014, I quizzed Julie about what she saw in the spirit world, and she was quite open in describing her experience. I then asked her to name the book she had read concerning near-death experiences. I expected her to list several titles, but she only mentioned a couple that had been published several years earlier. I then asked her what she had seen concerning the future, and she became hesitant to say very much. I actually took this as a good sign. If she intended to deceive me, she would likely have the whole scenario already laid out. As we concluded the conversation, I was sure this was the tall, dark-haired woman I had seen in visions years earlier, but I certainly wasn't going to tell her that. As I do with any other potential author, I prayed about whether we were supposed to publish this experience. I got strong confirmation about it, but I still proceeded cautiously. I contacted Julie again and told her I needed a solid first draft before I could send her a contract. She agreed, and over the next few days, she put together an outline and manuscript. When I received it, I was happy with the overall outline, but the manuscript was much shorter than I expected. Julie would need to expand on each chapter for it to be a publishable length. We also discussed that her book would be an additional witness to what the prophets and apostles had taught and not contradict their statements. She completely agreed. She emphasized to me that she fully supported the president of the LDS Church and was a lifelong active church member. At this point, I offered her a contract, and we began a process where she expanded one chapter at a time and then sent it to me. Our problem soon changed from not having enough material for a book to having more than we could ever fit into it. As she worked on the book, Julie's mind was flooded with memories of what she had seen, of what she had been shown in the Book of Life. For example, she wrote a segment about Joseph of Egypt and his brothers after they were reunited in Egypt. It was fascinating, but that story alone was more than the 10 typeset pages. So we decided to leave it out. When we moved into later chapters that covered future events, Julie had the burden of reliving the horrors she had seen concerning the coming troubles and destruction. It really wore her down emotionally, but she pushed forward with it. She could have been much more graphic and detailed in her descriptions, but that wasn't the purpose of her book. I'm happy with the overall hopeful feeling the book portrays. It shows that the Lord has been there for his faithful followers throughout all generations, including our own, if we follow the prophet and apostles. One curious dilemma was creating the book cover, because Julie had actually seen the book in her vision of the future. She tried to describe it to me, and she mentioned a field of red flowers. I'm usually the one who finds the cover images for Spring Creek books, and in this case, I searched throughout hundreds of images of red flowers on a couple of photo websites. I finally found one that was similar to her description, but I knew it wasn't right. I gave up and went to bed, only to awake with a start in the middle of the night. A voice said, "The image is there now." I went out to the computer, opened the photo website, and then typed in field of red flowers. The image was right there on the first page. Our cover designer put it together the next day and sent it to Julie, who quickly responded, "That's it. That's amazing." Julie's second book, The Time Is Now, was written in a similar manner, including another heavenly intervention in finding the right cover image. The book focuses on the words of the prophets concerning the latter days, with additional insights from Julie on future events. She also gives advice on how to spiritually and temporarily prepare for what is coming. Julie is a humble, kind person who simply seeks to do the Lord's will. There's so much more I could share concerning Julie's books, but I feel that is all I should say right now. The books have blessed many lives in helping people recognize and understand the Lord's love for each of us. If you haven't read them, they are worth your time. In my next entry, I'm going to describe my time between my first and second near-death experiences, including my mission in northern New Jersey. Let's just say the city of Newark was an interesting place to live with a slightly torn veil. I saw some frightening things, but I also saw miracles happen. Now, in my opinion, his account of meeting up with Julie Rowe is very similar to what we've heard her say about meeting up with Chad initially. So there's really nothing too big going on there. Anything in this post regarding Julie Rowe, we've already heard come out of her mouth. I hope wherever this video finds you, again, you are safe and healthy. I wish nothing but the best for you and all of your family. I'm sending good vibes anywhere I can because the situation we all find ourselves in is extremely confusing and frustrating. I hope you're finding creative ways to get by, and I thank you for hanging out with me. So you guys, take care, make good choices, be safe out there, and I will talk to you guys in the next video. Bye, guys.